In today's fast-evolving workplace, the convergence of multiple generations brings forth a tapestry of perspectives, experiences, and approaches that profoundly shape organisational culture. That's why we have made this the focus of our latest research report titled Cultivating Healthy Intergenerational Teams. And through this research, we have uncovered not just the challenges, but also the opportunities that arise when generations collaborate effectively. So joining me today to discuss some of our latest insights from this study is McCrindle's Managing Director and author of this report, Sophie Renton. Sophie, welcome back to the Future Report podcast.
Thanks, Ash. As always, delighted to be here.
I feel like every time we get introduced at a conference, people stumble over the word McCrindle, and I have just done that, so now I can put myself in their shoes. But so delighted to have you as always and talk about a topic that we both get to delve into a lot in our roles and out speaking at conferences and for organisations. And we've done some various studies on each generation, on different generations, and I feel like every time people always say, so how can the generations work together? And we often give advice, but we thought, let's make this the focus of a whole study, which we have done. And we do talk a fair bit about generational intelligence in this report. So I thought perhaps, Sophie, you could start off by, I guess, defining what we mean by this for our listeners today.
Yeah, I guess it is a new term, generational intelligence, not one that's been used super frequently, but something that we're always thinking about pretty much in every study that we do. We're looking at what the different generations think and how they behave. And generational intelligence really refers to the ability to understand, appreciate, communicate, and collaborate effectively across those different age groups or the different generational groups. And I guess it's built upon an understanding and an awareness that the era in which people grow up shapes their perspectives, their expectations, and their understanding of the world around them. And then that in turn influences how they behave in different circumstances. And so we, I guess, developed a generational intelligence framework in this study and, using survey insights as we always love to do. And we really addressed five key components in there around the intellectual side of things, so that awareness that the different generational differences actually exist, the emotional side and appreciation and value of different generational perspectives, the social side, so intentional behaviors that bridge those generational gaps, from a leadership lens, so how effectively are people adjusting their coaching and managing communication styles to better engage the generations, and then that future lens, so thinking about investing in emerging generations to future-proof. So we did a survey, pulled all those insights together and, identified these pillars of generational intelligence and used some of that as a lens throughout this report.
I think it's, like you mentioned, we hear a lot around emotional intelligence and IQ and EQ, and now we've got GQ kind of coming in. And I think for me, and we've talked about this on the podcast before, in terms of people asking, oh, is something characteristic of a generation or is it a life stage? And I think for me, the thing that makes the most sense is that phrase you mentioned earlier around awareness that an era in which people grow up shapes their perspective, expectation, and understanding. And it's kind of like we're understanding the context of their formative years, even though there'll be some similarities between everyone who's in their early 20s, whether that's today or a few decades ago, but it's more about what's happened, what are those technologies and societal events, and how does that shape a whole collective kind of perspective or behavior. So it's, I think, really interesting area to study. And as we think about the workforce and our communities, we've got a few different generations engaging. Which generations, Soph, currently comprise our workforce, and how is this projected to change over the coming years?
So today we have our Gen Zs, Gen Ys, Gen Xs, and our baby boomers. So by the year 2034, so in just a decade, 10 years time, sounds so far off, right? The 2034 and they're like, oh, 10 years. Mm-hmm. Then you start thinking how old you'll be in 10 years and then that's another scary thought. But in that 10-year time frame, our baby boomers will likely have shifted out of the workforce. So they'll have all reached their retirement age. So most will have either gone from full-time down to part-time or be doing kind of their own thing. So downshifting in that space. And so we'll have 19% will be our Gen X's, 32% will be Gen Y, 34% Gen Z, and 15% of the workforce will be Generation Alpha, who are just starting to enter high school today. So a vastly different workforce in just 10 years' time.
Yeah, it's I think it's a really great validation point for even this study. And I know it's, and that's what we do at McCrindle, it's kind of evidence-based insights. And I think for people, they're like, oh, why do we need to learn about different generations? And you know, we always say, well, there's this slide and this graph which shows how many different generations are going to be working, and all those young ones, they won't be here for a while. It's like, nope, they're coming faster than we probably expect and we think. So really important to keep in mind. As we think about different generations, Soph, what kind of different mindsets did the research kind of uncover as to what each generation is kind of bringing to the workplace?
Yeah, it was really interesting when we dug into the mindset that there were some things that the generations were different on, and then there were some things that the generations were aligned on. And I think it's always good to frame when we're talking about the workplace that the emerging generation needs to recognize that they're coming into a pre-established kind of culture and workplace that's already there with its rules, its processes, its frameworks. And, you know, often there's those tension points of, like these young guys come in, they just want to change everything. And it's like, well, okay, emerging generation, let's come in with an awareness that people are already operating in this space. But then our established generations also need to have that perspective of like, oh, how do we embrace and learn and create an environment where the emerging generation can actually contribute their perspectives? And if we both, I guess, sides come, and I don't even like talking sides because that creates division right there, but if we think about, you know, those that are established and those that are coming in or emerging, if they both come with that framework and that mindset, that really can create a much healthier cohesive environment from the very beginning. But if we're thinking about what were maybe some of those different generational mindsets that came in, you know, there's a perception that Gen Z are lazy and entitled in the workplace. And we actually gave a scenario of a question of saying, you know, if you've completed all your tasks before the end of the day, the workday is over, would you sign off for the day or would you find additional tasks? And, you know, we gave three options for each side of that. So were they much more likely to do it, somewhat more likely to do it, or slightly more likely? And overall, we found about 88%, you know, would find those additional tasks. And so the generations at a high level are largely consistent that they're all going to jump back in, find additional tasks. But when you just looked at those that are much more likely to fulfill their hours, so they're like, nope, I work 9 to 5 and that is my absolute and I'm not going to do anything or deviate from that. Our baby boomers are the most likely to kind of hold to that opinion at 51%, and Gen Z are the lowest at 36%. And so whilst Gen Z will find those additional tasks to do, the, I guess, rigor or the mindset or the perspective or the approach to that is likely different, where they've got that different approach to workplace flexibility, potentially even, you know, responsibility around fulfilling what's allocated to them. But I do want to just make a note in defense of Gen Z here that, you know, not everything is bad, that it's actually more about engagement in the workplace than about age as to whether people will find additional tasks to do. So those that are very low engagement in the workplace are the most likely to sign off, more so than age. So it's more about engagement than age that really shifts that. But also thinking about one around, do people prefer that having clear boundaries or an integrated approach where they can choose to work or do personal things depending on what suits them best? And I think with the pandemic, there's been a lot of conversation that, you know, everyone wants an integrated lifestyle. They just want to kind of work on their own terms. But we actually found that pretty much 4 in 5 like to have clear boundaries between their work and their personal life. And our baby boomers are actually the ones that prefer to have a more integrated approach to work depending on what suits them best. So Gen Z, they do like that flex. And I think probably my social observation is that everyone likes clear boundaries for work to stay at work, but they like flex when it's bringing personal into work time, but not work time into personal time. So it's a bit of an interesting kind of catch-22 on there. But Yeah, there's some things that the generations are aligned on and the mindsets they bring to work, and some things that are different. Other things that we found was, you know, what are the influences shaping their perspectives of work? So Gen Z are really influenced by TikTok, about 20% of them. You know, mentors still highly influence their perspectives on work, but we've got to recognize that social media does play a key part in that framing of their perspectives of work.
Mm, it's really interesting. I think I remember when we were kind of crafting this survey and hypothesizing and what's going to draw out some really interesting insights, and these are our hypothesis on how it's going to come out, and then obviously it comes out and you're either challenged or you're gratified or probably elements of both, as often it is for us. And yeah, it's interesting to see even those nuances and challenging of maybe our expectations of various generations, which I think is the goal of a lot of what we do here. It's like, what are the myths you have? Okay, let's either confirm or deny those by using research and insights. I know I guess even what you've shared so far, Soph, can lead to some challenges when you have different generations having different ways of working, expectations, ideas on flexibility and boundaries and what to do when all the work is done and what that means and what hard work means. And there's kind of a lot of different associations that each generation bring, and that can create some challenges. What kind of challenges did the research uncover about intergenerational teams where there are people of different ages sort of mixing in the workplace together?
Yeah, our study found that the top challenges of an intergenerational team was the different communication styles, the expectations of work ethic, the different approaches to conflict resolution, technical proficiency, and workplace flexibility. So those were the key challenges. And I think it is good to note that the communication styles and workplace ethic and approaches to conflict resolution were the main ones. And it's all around the human skills, the way that we engage, the way that we take the time to understand, the way that we understand our expectations and the expectations of someone else. And if we're not actually having those conversations within our teams and across our businesses to actually understand where people are coming from, then the opportunities for conflict and division are really high. Interesting, when we explored this by the generations, it was pretty consistent that different communication styles and expectations of work ethic were consistently in the top two or three. But Gen Z are the ones that are most likely to note that technical proficiency is a challenge for them. I think it's probably more of a comment on other people's technical proficiency is the challenge, but that's one of the issues they have in a intergenerational team. There was a lot of different ones that we found, and from lots of other studies, challenges around the frequency and communication of feedback and praise, recognizing that work actually fulfills a different role as life stage changes. So your Gen Z starting in their careers are looking for those progression, they're looking for feedback, they're looking for opportunity. Gen X are looking for recognition because they've done the hard slog, they've worked, they've established themselves, and they want that recognition while they're caring for their family and their kids. So work's fulfilling a different role in a different kind of space. When we looked at what people are looking for in a workplace, Gen Z is really looking for that collaborative and safe space to share ideas, whereas maybe those that have been in the workforce for a bit longer are like, I've got so many things on my to-do list to get done, I just want to pump them through, and having a bit more of that efficient and productive approach. So I think as leaders, it's recognizing what leadership style is needed for each generation and recognizing and understanding the mindset, the approach, and the needs of those generations, and helping to explain that to other people on the team so that they can actually come with that mindset of seeking first to understand and then being understood. Because if we can understand, okay, what role is work actually fulfilling in this person's life right now? What are some of the challenges that they're facing, you know, outside of the workplace? What are their preferences of communication styles, and how do they consume information? If we know those questions and actually care about the person, we're going to bring a lot more cohesion to our teams and bring a level of generational intelligence to the way that we're interacting.
Yeah, it's some really, there's some really great advice there. And yeah, I think it is interesting to see that different communication styles does come out as a pretty big kind of challenge that people can encounter. And yeah, I think it makes a lot of sense as people think about, yeah, the different ways that each generation, again, was raised in technology and, you know, how they use that and who prefers email versus, you know, I guess like WhatsApp and group chats, but then
the
face-to-face meeting, exactly. And then you've got even like ways of communicating with regards to leadership, if it's more inspiring or authoritative. Like there's kind of, I think, a few different ways that probably expresses itself. So that can be, I guess, a challenge for many people. But the inverse of that, of course, is that there are also some opportunities that arise when we learn to work well with people from different generations. What kind of opportunities, Soph, do you think do arise when we learn how to do that well?
There are so many opportunities, and I think at McCrindle we're very passionate about this area of seeing the generations work well together, because when you've got a really strong intergenerational team, it helps drive innovation, fosters that dynamic workplace culture. The key opportunity I think that you get is that opportunity for young and old to learn from each other. And it's really powerful when we think about that generational learning, not just as a linear from the older to the younger, but as post-linear or post-structural, where people are learning from whoever has the skills to teach on that topic best, regardless of age. And so your baby boomer might be learning from your Gen Z when they're talking about one area, but then your Gen Z might be learning from your Gen X in another area. And it's going, who's best for that role rather than age or position. So the opportunities for young and old to learn from each other is huge. I think there's also this collectively increased adaptability to change. So our younger generations, they often bring such a enthusiasm and optimism to the workplace, and it's beautiful. And sometimes when you've been there for a while, you're like, oh, just do things the way they've always been done. It's easy. We don't have to think. We don't have to get creative. But it's a really good tension when you can bring enthusiasm and experience together. And I think an intergenerational team that can leverage that enthusiasm and the experience of those that have been there that little bit longer and kind of have some guardrails or some structures to innovate within, you can get some fantastic results in that space. And high trust really needs to be, or high trust really underpins that approach being able to take place, of generations learning from each other, of generations being able to leverage each other's experience. You've really got to invest in building that foundation of trust and vulnerability and authenticity. And I think there's so many opportunities I can talk about with intergenerational teams, but just one more is thinking about diverse perspectives for innovative solutions. So, you know, we talk a lot about diversity in the world today, but I think sometimes we miss a crucial point of it, that it's not just diversity for diversity's sake, but diversity of thought becomes a strength when it's actually harnessed. So strong intergenerational teams, you know, you often have the benefit of different levels of work experience, exposure to different technologies, exposure to different times and mindsets and values that people were shaped in. And it can help a team look at a problem from many different angles. But what you need to do is not let that problem divide you, but let it actually unite you, because remembering that you are all on the same team and using that diversity of thought in a way that is harnessed rather than a way that causes friction, because it's in that sweet spot that you can find those really innovative solutions and leverage the experience of all the generations.
Wow, there's so many great benefits there, Soph, that you've outlined. And I feel like there was a lot of recommendations and advice in there as well. But my final question for you today, which I know is peppered throughout the report and peppered throughout so much of our content and writing and insights, are advice and recommendations. And you put some really fantastic recommendations in this report for people. So in light of all these insights, what recommendations do you have for people who are trying to build healthy intergenerational teams?
Well, the first one is building a culture of respect for every generation throughout the organization. We ask people in, you know, healthy intergenerational teams that you've been in, like, what are those key elements that really help build that strong team? And it's having that foundation and underpinning of respect, of value for every single person, regardless of their age, recognizing that they're a human and they have something wonderful to contribute. And that can't just be held by one person, but it needs to be a culture throughout the whole organization. So if that's something that you look at your organization, you go, oh, that's not there, that's where you need to start.
Mm-hmm.
The second is to lead by example. So you can't just have someone in your team that's great of it, and if you as a leader aren't living it out, it's never going to fly. If you look at your organization and go, oh, we don't have great cohesion across our generations, take a look at the way that you are engaging, because everything generally flows from the top and we need to lead by example. The third is developing a common language. One of the greatest challenges of an intergenerational team is that different communication styles, the different words that people even use. You know, you often hear the Gen Z, the older generations go like, I have no idea what this next generation is saying. And, you know, even me, sometimes I'm like, we've got Gen Zs on our team. And I'm like, I don't know what that slang means. I'm like, can you explain that to me? And, you know, I'm not that much older. But developing this common language where everyone's on the same page, where you can communicate clearly, that you can have fun on your differences, but at the end of the day, there's a sense of unity and we're in this together. The next one is creating those intergenerational learning opportunities. It's one of the greatest strengths of an intergenerational team is to learn from each other. And, you know, we talk a lot about it. We haven't really touched on it in this podcast, but about the intergenerational knowledge transfer, that with our baby boomers exiting out of the workforce, there is so much knowledge, social capital, experience that is caught up in that generation, that if we don't create the opportunities for intergenerational mentoring and learning, it may just walk out the door and organizations will be worse off because of it. So intentionally create those intergenerational learning opportunities. And then the last recommendation is just to remember to have fun. When we ask the generations what they value in the workplace, all of them said having fun. It was in one of their top five. So it's not just about Gen Z that want work to be fun. They maybe push it more than the other generations. But everyone wants to come to a place that they enjoy being in every day, where their perspectives are valued, their contributions are appreciated, and they're building something of value together.
Such great insights. So such practical insights as well. And as I was hearing you share these great recommendations, I was thinking about how, like you kind of alluded to at the end there, that I think despite all of our differences, whether they be generational or otherwise, we're human beings at the end of the day, and we all want like those same things around working with purpose and working in a place that we're seen and valued and heard and accepted and that we're included and doing good work. And I think when we have those people of different ages and generations, it can cause some challenges and some friction, but there is a lot of opportunity to create unity amongst that particular element of diversity. So yeah, fabulous insights. As always, thank you so much for your insights today and for working on this fabulous report for us as well. So
pleasure.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, including this latest study, we would recommend that you subscribe to McCrindle Plus, which is our new platform that gives you access to all of our insights. Of course, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or simply head to McCrindle.com for more information. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.